Good morning. It's good to see all of your faces here this morning as we gather here for our time of worship. As we look at our announcements for this coming week, there's a few of them. Just be aware, trustees will be meeting on the 19th at 7 here at the church. And as I recall, I believe it didn't make the bulletin, but I believe the day before on the 18th, the Christian Ed Committee will be meeting at 5 p.m. on that afternoon on the 18th, I believe. Also, just be aware, as I kind of said last week, that had we not been in a pandemic, I'd actually probably be leaving and be out of town the next few days for a retreat that's part of the one of my what's called residency requirements as part of our ordination process in the United Methodist Church. And because of the pandemic, though, we are not meeting in person, but instead are meeting through Zoom. And so the next couple of days, I will be doing that. Now, I won't be going anywhere. I'll be here in town. And I can assure you, I mean, it's not that I'm dreading it, it's just, it's not vacation. You're probably thinking, well, you were just on vacation, you're taking another one. Well, no, it's a retreat, but it's about the ordination process and some of the things that we're required to do. And so I will be in town, I just won't be in the office tomorrow or Tuesday. I'll be at home doing this retreat online, but again, if any of you need anything, if there's an emergency especially, please feel free to call my cell phone. Otherwise, if it's something that's not an emergency, that maybe you just have a question or need to leave a message or something, feel free to call Julie at the office and leave a message with her, and she'll see that I get it later. I will then plan to be back in the office on both Wednesday and Thursday morning. But again, tell them, feel free to get a hold of me if there are any other emergencies. Are there any announcements any of you have this morning before we begin our time of worship? If not, I invite you to please stand, and will you join with me in our call to worship? How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. On the beard of Aaron, roaming down over the collars of his robes. For there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore. Our hymn of praise, great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
You may be seated. I see one or two younger folks, if they'd like to come forward and join us in the children's sermon. No, you don't want to come up? No? Nobody wants to come up. Well, I was going to talk to you about my little dog. You don't want to come up and hear about the little dog? See my little dog in this picture? You want to come up? It's all right. That's okay. Well, if you don't want to come up, that's fine. But I'm just going to take a moment and talk. If I don't know if you can see him. I'll come back to you for just a second and I'll show you. This is my little dog named Dobie. Now, do you have a dog or cat or pets at home? You do. Okay. And do you feed the pet? Do you feed the pet? What kind of stuff do you feed them? Do you know? Cat food, yep. Well, I feed Dobie. I have to feed him canned dog food because he's got to eat food that's soft because he's older and he doesn't have many of his teeth left. So he has to eat canned food. Well, we love our pets, don't we? You love your cat. I love my dog. We love our pets. But when we eat, like when you have meals with your family, you all eat first, don't you? And usually our pets eat second. But that doesn't mean that we don't love our pets. And the reason why I'm talking about our pets today is because in a little bit, we're going to hear a story from Jesus. And Jesus is going to talk about a woman who comes to him and wants him to heal her daughter. And Jesus says to her at first, well, I've only come for the people of the house of Israel. Because she doesn't live in Israel, Jesus is saying to her, well, I can't really help you because you aren't from Israel. Now, it isn't that Jesus didn't love her, but his focus is on the people of Israel. But she's persistent, and she says, even the dogs eat what their masters throw from the table. And so what she's saying is, yes, but I'm still here and I need to be fed. And so Jesus does just what she says, and he heals her daughter. What we need to remember with our pets, of course, we love them, but they aren't going to be always the primary part of our concern at first. Jesus loves us all, even if we're not of the same family or we come from different countries or wherever. Jesus loves all of us no matter what, and that's the important lesson that we learn here today, that Jesus loves us all and wants only what's best for all of us. We'd all join with me in a prayer. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for always loving us and helping to remind us to always be persistent, to ask for what we need, and to always be thankful. In Jesus' name, amen. And again, a reminder, while we aren't passing the offering plate as we are normally accustomed to, there are plates in the back, and there's one over here for you to leave your offering if you so choose. And in response to our weekly offering, together will you join with me in our offertory prayer? Let us pray. God of love and mercy, we give you thanks that the compassion of Christ was challenged to move beyond the people of one community. May it be a reminder to us, his disciples, to follow his example in our living and our giving. Help us to see beyond our walls, beyond our communities, divides of nation, race, and creed, and to be generous as we share our blessings that have their source in you. God of us all, we pray in the name of our Rock and Redeemer. In Christ we pray. Amen. You may be seated. And we've come now to a time of sharing our joys and concerns. What joys or concerns do you have this morning?
That husband of mine had a birthday this past week.
That husband of yours had a birthday this past week. Well, there's birthday blessings to you. And a little bird told me it's someone else's birthday today, Brad Merkland in the back. So we want to wish both of you happy birthday. Are there any other birthdays? Or I know we have an anniversary here. The Millikens have celebrated their anniversary recently. So we want to wish both of them anniversary blessings. Are there any other joys to share? Yes. You did that day. Okay, well, birthday or anniversary blessings to you too, Leah. Thank you. To both of you and Tom, are there any others? I have a little bit of a joy to share about my newest nephew, Weston. He's about 8 months now, and my sister and her husband have been debating what some of his first words were going to be or are going to be, and they were you know, mom was hoping it'll be mom, dad was hoping it would be dad. Well, the other night, they're on vacation in South Dakota, and his uncle was giving him a bath. And as he was giving his bath, Weston called out and said, "Mom, mom, 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 ma." So his uncle called my sister in and said, "You'll never guess what he said." And of course, Sue didn't want to believe it at first, but then he finally said it for her and said, "Mom, mom, 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 ma." Well, you can only imagine the elation that she had that his first word was mom. But a little bit later, dad was out doing something. When dad showed up, then we said, "Dad, dad, 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 dad." So dad was as equally happy as well. My mom was sharing this story with me last night, and I said, "Well, it just goes to show Weston is very much a diplomat at a very early age." So just a little joyful story to share with you. We want to, of course, remember the Rose family this coming week. Now, of course, Phyllis passed away earlier this spring, but the family will be having her memorial service here at the church on Saturday morning, and we want to think and pray for them as they gather and remember and celebrate her life. We also want to remember the family of Sheila Davis. For those of you who know and remember her, she was a member of this community, had been living in Denver recently, and passed away last week. And we want to remember Sheila's family as well. Yes, Althea. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry, Althea. Thank you for sharing. Well, we certainly want to pray for you and your entire family, Althea. Thank you for sharing. For Althea's family and the loss of her mother this past week. So we want to pray for her and all of them. Are there any others? Most certainly, Pat. Thank you. Thank you. We will keep them in our prayers. Are there any others? Together, then, let us join in this, our time of prayer. And again, a reminder, as I offer each prayer intercession, I will conclude it by saying, Lord, your mercy, and respond, of course, by saying, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you again for this time together and for all of the many wonderful blessings you have given us. You have blessed us in this creation, O God, with an earth that provides for our needs, our sustenance. And we thank you for the beauty that we find. We also thank you for the gift, the community of family and friends, both near and far, O God. For all of these good gifts, we thank you. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we have not always done your will, though. We at times have become selfish. We have turned against you and against one another. We have fallen short of your glory, O God, and of your expectation and hope. We come before you this morning humbly asking for your forgiveness. Have grace and mercy on us and forgive us of our waywardness, O God. And help us so that we too can forgive others who may have wronged us. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we lift up before you all those in our midst and in our community who are ill or hospitalized or recovering, O God. We lift up those whose names appear in our bulletin who are ill or hospitalized or recovering. We lift up those whose names have been raised here this morning who are suffering from heart ailments and other things, O God, and we pray for those in other places who may be suffering in this pandemic due to the coronavirus. We just ask, O God, you be with them, you be with the doctors, nurses, and all others who tend to their care, and give them healing hands of restoration. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we lift up before you those who are suffering in the loss of loved ones. We especially this morning, O God, lift up our sister Althea and ask that you be with her and her family, comfort them in their grief and sadness and the loss of her mother. Be with others, be with the family of Sheila Davis and of Phyllis Rolfe, and be with them as they too gather and remember their loved one's life. God, comfort them in their grief. Help them to know that through your love, their loved ones are only gone to our sight, and that their lives live on in the love of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we continue to live with uncertainty and for many with anxiety. And we lift up this morning those in our schools, our administrators, teachers, staff members, as well as students who are finding themselves returning to the classroom in the next few days and weeks. There's still a lot of uncertainty. There is some fear and anxiety on behalf of so many, oh God. And we just ask for you to help calm that anxiety. Be with those who lead in uncertain times. And most importantly, God, keep your children, our students, our children, keep them, keep the teachers, staff, administrators, keep them safe. Watch over and protect them all, oh God. Guide our leaders that they can make decisions for the safety and well-being of everyone, not relying on political pressure, but God, on relying upon what is best in keeping our people and communities safe. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we thank you again for the gift of life, and we celebrate in joy with the Millikens and the Kellers and all others who are celebrating anniversaries this past week and coming week. Be with them and their celebrations, and be with those celebrating birthdays this coming week. Oh God, we thank you again for the gift of life and the blessing of companionship, of marriage, and the joys that it brings us. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we lift up those who are affected by the wildfires, especially in Colorado and other places around the country where it is so devastatingly hot and dry. Be with the firefighters, the men and women on the front lines who are doing their best to protect property and lives, oh God. And we lift up those who may have lost property in these fires. Be with all of them, oh God. Lord, in your mercy. For all of these concerns that have been raised here, and for any others that may remain yet in our hearts and in our minds, oh God, we ask that you would hear and receive them all. And now, with the confidence as children of God, together let us pray the prayer that Jesus himself taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our Old Testament reading for this morning is from Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 through 15. We continue to hear about Joseph and his brothers. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." No one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. When Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me," and they came closer, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine that has been in this land 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest, God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there. Since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here.' Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all of his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him." Our next reading is from Paul's letter to the church in Rome, chapter 11, verses 1 through 2a and verses 29 through 32. "I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable, just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience. So they now have been disobedient in order that, by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that he may be merciful to all." A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 15, verses 21 through 28. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then a Canaanite woman came from that region and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Jesus then answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. The word of God for the people of God. This is the word of the Lord. You may remain seated as we join in singing our next hymn. Thank you. Please pray for me as I pray for you as we think and reflect upon our scripture passages together. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and may the meditation in all of our hearts and minds be acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock and our refuge, a very present help in trouble. Amen. This morning, I want to share with you about a woman that I used to know when I lived up in Nebraska, who was a member of the local Lutheran congregation where I was their accompanist for several years. This woman's name was Linda. Her and her husband, Ron, faithfully attended church. They were longtime members of the church and community. One thing I will always remember about Linda was that, unfortunately, due to her health and age, of course, she had back problems and could not stand up for any real length of time. But in their time there at that church, her and Ron kind of saw themselves as the unofficial appointed greeters in that church. And almost every Sunday that they were there, you would find Linda perched on the stairway that led up to the choir loft. You would see her there sitting on those steps, facing the main entrance to greet people as they came in. And there was never a Sunday when I would come in to make my way up to the choir loft where the piano and organ were that Linda would always say, "Hello, friend," and always had a warm greeting for me. The other thing was countless number of times after worship when we'd leave, there'd be times I would be following her and her husband out to their vehicles. And I'd always say to Linda as we were partying that morning, I'd always say, "Have a good week." And her response was always the same. Joyfully, she'd respond by saying, "I will if you will, friend." But those are some of the things I remember about Linda. The one thing, though, I remember most about her, though, was her gift of persistence. I can remember one time the local post office there in Chadron had one of the largest American flags there in town. You probably wouldn't find any bigger flag that was proudly displayed in front of the building on the flagpole. Well, one evening a windstorm came through and unfortunately tore the flag and wrapped it around the flagpole. And unfortunately, to bring it down could not be done because the ropes had got twisted and knotted too, and it would take someone in a bucket truck to go up to repair or bring down the flag. Unfortunately, the post office tried to reach out, tried to find someone who had a truck that was willing to, but unfortunately, they weren't having much luck. And of course, Linda was one who noticed this. And after about 2 or 3 days of the flag not being fixed, she started calling people. And I was in the police department at the time, dispatching one morning when she called me. And she said, "Tony, I'm calling about that flag in front of the post office. You know, it has been torn and in disarray for almost the past week. Is there anything you guys there at the police department could do?" And I said, "I don't know, Linda. It's not really a criminal matter, but we'll see what we can do." Well, I made a few phone calls to some connections around town I knew, and unfortunately, I got a no. I tried the local power company, and they said, well, unfortunately, because of liability issues, they were unable to help. I tried a local electrician that I knew had a truck, and he said, well, I don't think mine will reach up that high enough. So I didn't know what to do either. But the next day, Linda called again and said, "Here we are. Do you have any news yet?" And I said, "No, Linda, but I'm trying." She said, "Well, I'll keep trying too." Well, this daily ritual went on for over a week. And in that time, Linda not only called me, she called City Hall, she called the city manager, she called several members of the city council to see what they could do. Finally, by the end of that week, We got the fire department to agree to bring down their ladder truck. And with the police department there to help direct traffic, we were finally able to get somebody up there and bring the torn flag down and get it replaced with a new flag. I would like to think that was all in part because of Linda's persistence. That was her gift, whether it was seeing that a local flag repaired was done or seeing that things in the local church were done. Linda had a heart for people. She was one of these types that never knew a stranger. And she always felt when there was a visitor or newcomer to the community and they came to church, they needed to really be welcomed. And she started a welcome ministry by seeing that cookies were prepared. And so as any visitors or newcomers came to worship, that they were given a cookie and a card to greet them when they came. That was her gift of persistence. Sadly, Linda passed away about 3 years ago, and within a year, her husband Ron passed away. And I'd like to only think that heaven is probably a much better place for her, for everyone right now, because Linda, I'm sure, is up there making sure things are running properly and probably being persistent. If you saw the movie The Shawshank Redemption, you'll remember the main character, Andy Dufresne, in the movie, had repeatedly, while he was in prison, wrote to the state trying to get a library started. And after letters that he sent almost weekly for over a year or so, he got a response and finally got some seed money from the government. And the letter that said, you know, we have gotten your letters, and what it more or less said is, you know, we're kind of tired of getting your letters, so here's some money. Now we start your library and please leave us alone. The gift of persistence, as the saying says, and that's not a mistake. That the sermon title is titled that. I know it's the early bird gets the worm and the greasy wheel, you know, gets the grease, or the squeaky wheel gets the grease. But needless to say, the gift of persistence can get things done when they need to. There's a lot of people, and you may be one of them. I'm not, but there's a lot of people, the way our minds tick. I know there are many of you who are those types that when you see something that needs to be done, it needs to be done. Let's get it done and do it. Those are the folks I know who just roll their eyes when it's told to them, well, we need to put it before the committee. Some of you probably can relate to people like that, or maybe, again, you yourself are one of those types of people. That you see things that need to be done and you want to get them done. Those are often the type of people who show us that gift of persistence. Linda was one of them. Andy in the Shawshank Redemption was one of them. And the story that we hear this morning of this Canaanite woman, she too was persistent. Imagine the scene, if you will. Again, Jesus is out there with his followers, with the disciples, and all who are following him. They're now traveling around. They're following Jesus. So if you can picture Jesus with a little bit of an entourage, if you will. And you can imagine some of those disciples, as we have learned, they're getting kind of protective of who gets near Jesus and who can talk to him. And so there's this Canaanite woman. A woman who's seen as a foreigner. And everywhere where Jesus goes, there she is in the crowd, waving her hands, trying to get Jesus' attention, saying, Jesus, I need to talk to you. There was a woman that I used to know, another one in Shadron, that her name was Deborah. And Deborah had a lot of issues. And if she got to talking to you, she could talk your ear off. And she was one of these people I can remember going downtown and going into a local restaurant and coming out one afternoon and looking down the sidewalk and seeing her down there and knowing that my path had to go right by here. And I thought, oh no, what am I going to do? So I was going to go back into the building and wait her out. But as I turned, she saw me and called out my name, and I knew I couldn't escape. So I went and talked to her for a little while. But you probably know those people too. And that's kind of the picture I see with this Canaanite woman. That when she came around, those disciples and those following Jesus probably just rolled their eyes thinking, oh, here she is again. Keeping on saying, Jesus, I need to talk to you. Finally, she's somehow able to break through those crowds from those disciples and others who followed, and she's finally able to get to Jesus, and she says to him, she says, Jesus, I need your help. Lord, have mercy on me, but have mercy on my daughter, for she is possessed and she needs help. I need you to heal her. And Jesus turns and looks at her, and he says to her, well, I'm sorry, but I'm only here for the people of Israel. I can only imagine the high fives and the fist pumps that were probably happening amongst those disciples and others as they were probably thinking to themselves, yes, Jesus finally gets it. He finally gets it, and that you know, he's agreeing with what we are trying to do here and protect him and insulate him. He finally gets it. But this woman is not to be deterred. She doesn't cower away and then walk away disappointed. Instead, she persists and she says, well, yes, that might be, but even the dogs wait for the scraps that come from the table. And Jesus turns around and he looks at her and he says, woman, great is your faith. I will do as you ask. And as we heard, her daughter was instantly healed. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, this story has always been a little tough in that sense because, you know, the Gospels, we hear so much about Jesus' compassion that he had for everyone, it seemed. But this story is a little different because, again, of his response, what he initially says. And he says, you know, he says to her, well, I'm only really here for the house of Israel right now. And I think that's what he's trying to say is, well, my first and foremost concern right now is for the people in the house of Israel. Not that he gave her a flat no, he was just saying my focus needs to be on them for right now. As I was explaining to the kids, it's kind of like our pets. We love our pets, our dogs, our cats. We love them and we treat them and think of them as family, but more often than not, I doubt many of us probably see that they're fed first before our family, that we see to the needs of our family, of our sons and daughters, of our spouses and whomever, that we see to their needs first. And then we look to our animals, our pets. It's not that we don't love them, it's just that we sort of look at them secondly because our main focus is on our family. And in some way, I think that's what Jesus is thinking here. Well, my focus needs to be right now on this family, on my family in the house of Israel. But this woman persists in her faith. And Jesus is moved by that. And he says to her, great is your faith. I will do as you ask. What this story teaches us is a couple things. Again, the importance of being persistent in our faith. Now, because and when we go to God in prayer, whether it's in corporate prayer like we do here every Sunday or in our own personal lives, and we ask God for certain things, it doesn't mean that God is going to grant all that we ask just like that. That's not how God works, and that's not really how prayer works. Prayer is actually more of keeping a dialogue, if you will, a conversation going with God. And that's what God desires from us, is a conversation. Jesus sets the example in this story as that desire, that God wants us to spend time in conversation. But being in conversation means we need to at times be persistent. It's not that God doesn't hear our prayers. God does. But when we're persistent, when we keep talking to God, we become more aware of what's going on. We get to understand more how God is working in our lives and become more secure in knowing that God does hear us. Again, God isn't always going to act in the way that we hope or want. But if we're persistent in our prayers, we will see and understand that God does act in our lives. You know, I've shared with you about my younger sister, Shailene, and her husband, Darren. They have tried for a long time to have their first child. And about 2 years ago, they learned they were pregnant with twins. And the joy that they felt to finally know that they were going to have not one, but two children. But unfortunately, both children were lost in pregnancy. It was devastating to my sister and to Darren and both of our families, his and our family. But you know, I think of what his mother, Darren's mother, my mother, and others in the family kept saying, we just got to keep hoping and praying. Some way, somehow, God will answer our prayers. Not in the way that we hope, but God somehow will. And you know, through that persistence, that answer came in the form of this little baby about 8 months ago named Weston Allen. And Weston has been here to bless us ever since. And as my mom would say, that was certainly an answer to all of our prayers. Now, God may not necessarily act in the way that we hope or want, but God does hear our prayers. And that's what God desires from you and I, is to be in conversation. One thing I've seen and heard from a number of people, and I've seen this on Facebook, people commenting, if there's one good thing about the pandemic, is that it has helped families get together and to actually converse face to face with one another. Because of the closure of schools and all the different events that happened, families finally found time to have meals together, to share time together, and to be in conversation. It seems for many of us, we kind of lost that ability to be in conversation. But when those moments happen that we're able to dialogue and talk, we're able to learn and experience one another in new and different ways. And that's what the comments so many have said, getting to be with their families again in this way. And you see, that's what God through Christ desires of us. God wants to be part of our own lives, and the one way that we do that is by inviting God into our lives, into our conversations, and maintaining that conversation with God. And we do that through being persistent. And again, doesn't always mean things are going to go the way that we want, but God acts on our desires and our needs in the way that God feels is the best for us. That's what we have to keep hoping for and keep the faith, much like this Canaanite woman did. She knew it was probably a long shot and she would never get the chance probably to ever even talk to Jesus, let alone that he would even respond to her in the way that he did. And when she does get that moment and breaks through and she calls out and says, Jesus, I need your help, he more or less tells you, well, I'm sorry, but you're just not the person I'm helping right now. But she doesn't let that deter her, and she remains faithful. And through her persistence, through her faith, Jesus grants what is needed for that moment. Jesus comes to each of us and wants us to be in conversation too. Not all of us are blessed with that gift of perseverance. I'm not always sometimes because I sometimes want to give up, and that's just a part of me I have to be aware of. And for me to be persistent, I got to keep working at it. But there's others of you, I'm sure it comes a lot easier, and that's great. But we all need to be persistent in our faith. Because as the song that we sang a little bit ago, great is thy faithfulness. Great is our faithfulness when we are persistent and we keep in communication with God those things and desires that are close to our minds and hearts. And that conversation doesn't need to be in the formality of church or in a corporate prayer. Doesn't mean that you have to be, hands folded, head down all the time. A prayer to God can simply be a thought about a loved one maybe who's traveling, and your hope and desire that they make it to their destination safely. Or thought or hope for the countless number of children, teachers, administration, and staff members who are returning to school in the coming weeks, that they stay safe. Or for a grandchild that's starting college for the first time or returning, that they remain safe. Whatever the need is, God hears them all, spoken and unspoken. Brothers and sisters, may all of you be persistent and keep your faith alive. Amen. I invite you to please stand, and will you join with me in the words of the benediction? We leave this place as beloved children of God. We are all servants upheld by God and filled with God's Spirit. God holds our hands. God keeps our hearts. Our closing hymn, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace."